Thank you. Thank you for the introduction. I'll also like to thank the Academy and Professor Majumdar for allowing me to present our work in this forum. As the title of my talk suggests, we have been working in our lab to identify the role of epigenetic modification in inheritance. When we talk of inheritance, what we normally mean is transmission of genetic information from one generation to another, and this genetic information we mean DNA. And along with the what are called as Mendelian laws of inheritance, which were formulated way back in mid-1800s, these form the basic tenets of inheritance as we know of. But over the last several decades, more and more examples have been coming forward, which actually show not only inheritance of non-genetic information, but also of non-Mendelian inheritance. Some of the examples are, let me see, are listed in this slide here. I'm not going to go and tell you about all of them for paucity of time, and they are specific titles of individual talks. What I will do is just as a background to what we've been doing and to highlight the importance of epigenetic modifications in inheritance, I'll just take one example. Now, we all start our journey as a single cell, and that single cell is the zygote, which forms by the fusion of sperm nuclei, which brings in contribution from the father, and the egg, which brings in information, genetic information from the mother. Now, that fusion leads to a cascade of events, which finally results in an adult multicellular organism. Now, in early 1980s, people started thinking of a simple question, which was, now that apart from the sex chromosomes, all the genetic information in what comes from the sperm and the egg nucleus is almost the same. So could it be that if we actually bring in either fuse two egg nucleus, which happens in nature by through what is called as parthenogenesis, or bring in two sperm nuclei together and then ask whether in mammals, and this is the case in mammals, whether we could actually get a normal development? And they did these experiments, these very elegant experiments, through using a very novel experimental tool that they had designed, which is called as pronuclear transfers. What they essentially did was, they so for example, if you look on the left hand side, they from the fertilized egg, either they removed the female pronuclei, which brought in the maternal information, and then put another male pronuclei, which is basically coming from the sperm. And so now you have 2N, which is a required number of ploidy, or two sets which are essential for normal development. Same way, vice versa, they actually brought two female copies from the mother. One is called as androgenetic and the other one is called as gynogenetic, and then asked whether these can develop normally. And the results are here to see in this slide. You can see very well the control embryos where there's one maternal copy, one paternal copy, and normal development. But when you have two copies from the mother, the embryo is okay, but the placenta is not at all developed. These embryos actually die very early on. Androgenetic embryos don't have an embryo development at all, almost nothing, and but the placenta is very well developed. This brought out two important facts for mammals, and these were being done in mice. So for normal development, you require contribution both from maternal and paternal side, right? But most importantly, what it showed is that the progeny is recognizing the contribution from mother and father as not equal, right? Even though the genetic information was the same, they were using isogenic lines, but it was not same. It was, you could actually see that the development was not happening. And that forms the basis of what is called as genomic imprinting. And what it essentially means is that somehow the progeny, the cellular machinery in the progeny is recognizing that what came from the father, what came from the mother. And if I twist this argument again, somehow the mother and the father were sending the genetic information with some marks. And these marks, as we now know, are nothing but epigenetic modifications, which is either DNA modifications or modifications of histone proteins, or what I've not said here, but this is also becoming very clear, that small RNAs, regulatory non-coding RNAs, are also part of epigenetic modifications. In our lab, we've been working on various facets of epigenetic modifications, starting from genomic imprinting. We've also looked at a very a different set of roles of epigenetic modifications in infection, where we're looking at how epigenetic circuitry plays a very important role in the host-microbe interaction. But for today's talk, I will actually focus on this project that I've mentioned on the top right, which is the role of DNMT3L, a protein which is called as DNMT3L, and I'll try to show you that it has a role to play in epigenetic inheritance. This protein is a very interesting protein, as I said, because it's been classified as a DNA methyltransferase, but because it doesn't have catalytic domain, it doesn't, it can't perform DNA methylation, right? But it does modulate the DNA methylation in a cell by either interacting with other de novo DNA methyltransferases or through its interaction with different histones through histone modifications. And this work that I'm going to present was done by two of my PhD students, Gokul and Amit. And Gokul had actually identified this protein as a protein which was involved in cancer epigenetics. I'll not go into that particular part. But what he went on to show was that if you were to look at it very carefully, we could actually see a role for this protein in nuclear reprogramming. And how he found out was when he actually overexpressed this in mammalian cell lines, initially nothing happened, but over a period of around 20 generations of these cell passages, we actually started seeing a lot of morphological changes in these cells. And this was concomitant with what we see with the transcription profile. So you can see after 48 hours, there's hardly any change in the transcription profiles, but by passage 20, 25, there is huge amount of transcriptional changes. Amit actually then went on to actually look at the same thing, look at the role of DNMT3L in nuclear reprogramming, but in a more robust genetic model system. So he then went on to actually work with DNMT3L, but look at it in Drosophila. Now, Drosophila doesn't have this protein, right? So he made transgenic flies where using various genetic tools that are available, so and in such a way that you could actually control which cells of the Drosophila or when it should be expressed, this particular protein. And as Gokul had seen, he too, when he actually made these transgenic flies and expressed this protein in Drosophila, did not see anything much in the first generation. Mind you, there is a major difference in what Gokul did and what Amit did, because Gokul was working with cell lines, so he was only looking at somatic inheritance through mitosis. Whereas Amit actually was trying to do it in Drosophila, where for each generation, you need to pass this through germline. So we were looking at germline inheritance, where you have meiosis, and we know from previous works that most of the non-genetic information is erased during germ cells. So he didn't see anything in the first generation, but because Gokul had seen it much later, he actually kept on self-crossing these flies. And of course, he saw it, and he actually did it in various ways. I'm not going through the details of what all experiments he did. But in the fifth generation, wherever or whichever DNMT3L lines he used, or whichever inducers of DNMT3 expression that he used, which are these Gal4 lines, he would always see in some of the larvae these black spots that you can see, which are basically melanotic tumors. Now, another important thing that he actually noticed was that this did not happen in all the larvae. It was happening only in 5 to 7% of the larvae. And then when he actually kept on going further, self-crossing, he went up till almost 20th generation. In each generation, 5 to 7% of the larvae would actually have melanotic tumors. They would die off. Remaining were fertile. They would actually give progeny. And in the next generation, the same thing would happen. So always there was these 5 to 7% of the larvae which will die off. So this was very interesting to see what this phenotype. We then looked at all possible reasons why this could happen, apart from the role of DNMT3L, and none of those reasons actually turned out to be true. So neither was it that there was an overexpression after fifth generation or copy numbers changed. All those experiments that you can actually show that it could be instead of DNMT3L. But all the experiments failed. What he then did was, after 20th generation, he actually did crosses by which he actually removed or crossed out the inducer or the Gal4 drivers from these lines. So now you had DNMT3L transgenic flies, but there is no inducer of expression of DNMT3L. And as soon as he did that, you see now that there is no phenotype. So there are no melanotic tumors now being observed, indicating very clearly that whatever we were seeing was due to expression of DNMT3L. He then went ahead, and then started doing transcription profiling for all of them. So basically what he did was took RNA from all the from flies from all the generations, and then compared expression of these flies with flies where DNMT3L transgene was there but was not expressed. So we call it G0. So G0 versus transcription profile from all the other generations. And this I will show you in dot plots, where red and green crosses represents change in expression. So This is with G1 flies, and you can see some genes being overexpressed or underexpressed. In G2, these numbers increase a little bit. By G4, the tremendous amount of transcriptional changes happen and keeps on increasing. And by G5, which is where we see the phenotype, and these are this was the RNA derived from those larvae which had melanotic tumors, almost 3,500 genes were misregulated. The most satisfying of the dot plots that actually I liked was, he then went on to compare the transcription profile in the flies after G20, where he had actually removed the Gal4 driver or the inducer of TNMT3L. And you can see here, the transcription profile has gone back to normal. So almost normal. So this is just represented here again, and you can see there is transcription, transcriptional reprogramming, and it is gradual. It's not like it just happens and it stays like that. It has gone from G1 to G5. And after G5, we have seen that they remain constant into what we see in this G5 profile. Which then brought us to figure out what was, look at epigenetic modifications, because transcription is regulated by epigenetic modification. Because DNMT3L is a DNA methyl transferase, first thing that Amit actually then asked was, could it be DNA methylation? Now, normally Drosophila doesn't have or has no or very little DNA methylation. Anyway, he went ahead and actually tried to look at DNA methylation and then compared it with G0, where there is no expression of DNMT3L. So whatever little DNA methylation was there, it was constant across the, so there was no change in DNA methylation, but there was definitely change in histone modification, as this next slide shows you. So you can see some of the histone modification, and here we are looking at histone modification of methylation or histone methylation at different lysine residues in histone H3. And you can see at lysine 4, 36, there is a dramatic change in decrease in the level of H3K4 trimethylation. And these are just plotting the same thing here. You can see again, as like for transcription profiling, there was a gradual decrease in this epigenetic changes. Now, epigenetic changes change in some sense the phenotype or what we are actually looking at. And they've been compared, these changes in epigenetic modification have been compared to mutations of DNA, which also lead to can lead to phenotypic changes. And if we were to say, and they are usually called as epimutation, these changes. So you can see with in each generation, there is an accumulation of epimutations. So going from G3 to G4 to G5, each generation there is, looks like there is some amount, some new epimutations are being added on. And by G5, where you see the phenotype, it looks like there is a threshold reach, and that is when you actually seem to see the phenotype. We have looked at several other things in this. I'm not going into all others for paucity of time, but it clearly indicated that there was inheritance of something other than the DNA in these flies, which, as we can see from this slide here, is histone modification. We have also actually found out preliminary data is there. We also have some more data, but we've found that actually what we are seeing, these epimutations seem to be actually being passed on in a parent of origin specific manner, something which we see in genomic imprinting. But I'll leave it for some other time, that particular data. We also actually found out that PV group of proteins which are involved in transgenerational epigenetic inheritance are also involved. We actually did crosses to show that, and some work is going on in a lab to figure out what is the extra things that we can see. So this is just a summary of what I told you about DNMT3L, but basically we now know that DNMT3 is involved in inheritance of non-genetic information from one generation to another. This work was done in CDFD. Right now I'm shifted to IPTEC now, but this work wouldn't have been possible without the help from Rakesh Mishra, a lot of help from Rakesh Mishra in CCMB and his lab. Thank you very much.
I have a question for you. So you mentioned that DNMT3L is not a functional methyl transferase, right? And you said it actually has its action through interactions with, you know, related, I think it was 3A or 3B, I can't quite remember. So do you think this is a general, this is a unique kind of situation, or in other possible, you know, instances of genetic modification, you will have similar sort of control molecules? Would you call this a control molecule, or how would you describe it?
Yeah, so this looks like to be a regulatory molecule rather than actually a catalytic or a functional enzyme. This has been seen in various other cases. But basically, one another important aspect that I actually skipped for positive time is this is present only in mammals. It's not present anywhere else. And that's where you see the genomic imprinting. So there has been some kind of a correlation with genomic imprinting, but it's about regulation here. It's regulating in a way through its interaction, because 3A and 3B, while they do methylation, but they also interact with other histone and other epigenetic marks. And this one is only doing that modulation. And that's the important part of this particular model.
Right. So would you categorize it as a master regulator, or you think that there could be other molecules also that would...
There would be other molecules as well.
Okay. I don't see any other questions. So with that, I'm going to thank you very much for your talk, and thank you for making this nice presentation.
Thank you very much.